Today I've brought you to the wonderful JCB Lakes, where I'm going to talk you through all things big water method feeder fishing. I'm going to talk to you about is choosing the right feeder, because when you're on a big open water, it can be quite daunting looking at all the water in front of you in terms of how far you might have to cast, how much bait you might introduce, or how accurate you might need to be. So these are the sort of key things that I'm taking into account when I'm looking at the water in front of me. Now I've got a bit of an island off to my left, but I know a lot of the fish here live out towards the open water. I've got a lot of space to go out, and I'm going to have to try and work my way out, really, try and find exactly where the fish are, because the water is so big. It's not one of those waters where I'm just going to be able to lash 8mm pellets in short and catch a load of fish. So I'm going to have to go out and find the fish. Now, in order to do that, I want to be relatively accurate, because I might want to move left or right a little bit, and I'm going to want to cast a long way. Now, although I'm a huge, huge fan of a method feeder, I absolutely love them, especially when casting to islands and things like that. I know that this Banjo style of feeder with the weight all the way at the bottom, because the plastic's at the top and all the weight is loaded at the bottom, they cast so accurately and so much further in the same weight, I can get a lot more distance in my feeders. So, you know, there's not a lot of wind today. If I was to choose a 30 gram version of, say, the medium feeder, I'd be able to cast this 50, 60 meters, something like that, quite comfortably. And that's the sort of go-to feeder. That's my go-to starting size. Why a medium? Well, probably because I don't want to be piling in bait to start with. To begin with, I just want to introduce enough bait to try and catch the fish that are there. When I think I might have found a few fish, I might consider upping it then to a large feeder and introduce larger amounts of bait, and that larger amount of bait will hopefully gather the fish. If I ruin it and I need to go searching again, I'll step it down to the medium and take that medium feeder and almost go searching again for the fish. I'm not a big fan of boshing in the great big feeder from the start, because the trouble is, if I'm fishing in the wrong place, I'm just leaving bait all over the lake. So I want to try and find them first, and then I might up it a bit with a bigger feeder later on. Now, of course, it could get windier, or I might want to go even further. So the 45 gram medium is the current feeder that I'm fishing with, because I'm fishing about 70 meters out. So that 45 gram stays true on the cast. It means I'm hitting the clip cleanly every single time. And when it's laying there on the bottom, it's nice and secure. So even if I've got a big bow of line in the wind, I know my feeder is staying in place. Don't worry about big carp being nervous of big feeders. Think about carp anglers probably fishing 4 ounce, 5 ounce leads. You know, they're much heavier than us. So we can fish with heavier feeders. Don't be scared of them. The same thing applies with the big feeders. 45 gram is pretty much the smallest I use when I'm casting the big feeder any sort of distance. I need this weight at the bottom. I won't even be scared to up it to the 60 gram, the 2 ounce, and all my other gear reflects that. So these are the sort of things that I'm thinking about when I'm choosing what feeder to use on this sort of venue. Have a chat about bait now for today's session, and something a little bit different and a little bit interesting for me to try today. At Sonu Baits, Ian, who's the main man in charge there, came to me a few weeks back and said, I've got some beautiful 1mm pellets, would you like to try them in your fishing? I said, yes, Ian, yes, I definitely would, because they look absolutely stunning and I've been using them now for a few weeks. They're a really, really tiny pellet. They're a high fish meal content, and it's very, very obvious to me that the fish absolutely love eating them. And we talk a lot about using ground bait on a method, using 2mm on a method, maybe sort of some sort of crushed boilie on a method feeder. Well, for me, this is a perfect in between. This is giving me something that is going to achieve something different in the water, something different for the fish to eat, and it's got a very, very attractive quality to it. So I've mixed up a few of those today along with my usual 2 mils. They're dead easy to prepare. I got a 250 ml cup of water and poured them into a bag full of pellets. That's it. You don't want to soak these pellets like you do with a normal 2 mil pellet. When you get a 2 mil pellet, if you soak a 2 mil pellet, obviously the water gets into the pellet and it's all great. This needs to be treated more as a ground bait. So I put them in a bucket and I just put down that 250 ml of water, and you can see now all these pellets have taken on water. They're all soft. I can squeeze them into a ball so they can go on my feeder absolutely perfectly. And what I can do is I can use these with my 2 mils. I can use these on their own. I could even use them to make my ground bait a little bit coarser. So I think they're an excellent, excellent feed, and something that has already caught me a lot of carp here today and on two or three other venues already. So I'm really happy with those. They're a very, very nice product, something nice to look forward to. I've done my usual fin perfect 2 mils, took a bag of 2 mils, dunked them in the water for 2 minutes, took them out of the water, left them for an hour, and now I've got soft 2 mils all the way through, ready to go on the feeder. And then I've mixed up some very high fish meal, krill and squid. I like a really high fish meal ground bait, particularly if I'm searching for fish. I want something really smelly. You know, I want something that the fish are gonna come into. I'm on a big water, I'm on big open water. This isn't the place for weak baits. This is the place for strong, attractive baits. That's why I sometimes use the Scopex and things like that as well, because I want maximum attraction to my bait. So it's really straightforward. I absolutely love yellow and pink wafters, and I always pick out a few of the old white and yellows as well. That's a particular favorite of mine. So I tend to have those three colors with me, work those colors throughout the day. And I've got a tub of 8 mil thin perfect pellets as well, just in case I want to feed some 8 mils on a line shorter, or even use one as a hook bait. So a really, really simple bait tray, but highly attractive to the fish that are in this lake. So the first thing I need to think about when I'm sat on the box ready to start the session is where I'm going to cast. The open water nature of fishing means that you're not going to be, I don't think personally you're going to be casting in and getting bites quickly. I think you're going to be casting in, you probably have to wait a little while for a fish to find your bait. So you're going to want to do the whole thing in stages. Now, I know with my equipment and the conditions on the day what sort of maximum range I've got. And just to give you an example, let's take, say, 70 meters as my maximum range I can cast, okay? The last thing I want to be doing is casting 70 meters at the start. I don't want to max out. I don't want to go to my limit right at the start of the session. I want to come back from that, give myself some space. Now, I also know that because it's quite a big open water, anything closer than probably 45, 50 meters is pretty much a waste of time. Maybe later in the day, perhaps, but generally speaking, not really worthwhile. So I'm going to go to about 50 meters to start with, and I would clip up to that distance. I would sort of clip up to what I believe is a comfortable cast. I'm not actually that specific on the distance. It's more what I believe is a nice, comfortable cast. So I'm going to cast out, I'm going to clip up, and then once I've got it in the water, I'm going to talk a little bit about my baits, so, and how and why I would use them. So we'll cast this out. First cast of the day, roughly about 50 meters. I'm saying about three quarters of what we're calling the so-called limit, all right? So that's what I'm going for. So I'm gonna start the stopwatch and I'm gonna give it about 10 minutes. Now, usually when it's warm, it's a nice day today, to be honest, I would usually like to try and bring that down. I wanna be probably 5 minutes maximum really in the water. But to start and try and find my fish, to try and find my sort of hot spot, I'm gonna give it about 10 minute casts. But I've also got a selection of baits I can play with. And this is really important as well, because again, I don't really know what the best bait is going to be. I don't know how I'm going to use these baits to get the most out of them. So I've sort of got a series of like almost like equations to work out. Distance, bait, how long I leave it, left, right. There's lots of things for me to consider. And I haven't actually got that many options. I've got one or two types of hook bait that I'm very confident in, which I think is important. And I've got these 1mm pellets, I've got my 2mm pellets, and I've got some ground bait if I need them, but this 1mm pellet is going to replace my ground bait really, I think, to begin with. If I'm struggling later in the session, I might get some ground bait out perhaps, but to be honest, to start with, I'm just going to look to use these in tandem. So what I've done, I took a big handful of each pellet, and I've got there 2mm and 1mm mixed together. So that's what I've started on around my Banjo feeder. I believe that the 1mm are gonna give me a lot of attraction. They're very fine. They're gonna waft around in the water. And the 2mm have still got that element of feed that we know fish absolutely love. So it's almost like a crush on your bait. Now, I might increase the amount of 2mm if I start catching. So if I'm sort of casting in the same place quite regularly, I might even like extra 2mm on there, because I don't want loads and loads of fine particles in the peg. But if I'm not catching and I want to try and attract some fish in, I might just go for these neat 1mm, something really fine that's going to attract some fish into the peg, very smelly, very strong fish meal pellets. And I can use those baits, but I'm going to give each session probably I would say 4, maybe 5 casts in each area. The biggest mistake I think people make is that they're too keen to change. 1, 2 casts, oh, that's no good. Put a couple of meters on, try again. A couple of meters isn't gonna do you much difference, to be honest. Nobody's that accurate when they're casting. For me, I'd rather work on an area and then make a significant move, like a 10 meter move, something like that, once I've already caught a few fish. So that's the plan today. That's my starting distance. The stopwatch is set. Let's see if we can get a pull. So this was my third chuck, I think. And we are about 6 minutes in, still on that 50 meter line. I'd actually just put the 1mm and the micro combination on, and I'd put one of the 8mm pellets on as well. I just fancied a pellet rather than a wafter at that time. And it's gone round, like I say, the big fish in here. So it's quite exciting. The bite was quite exciting. And I'm really pleased, because I didn't really want to be moving too early. Like I said, I felt like you're going to need a few casts. You don't know what your target's going to be today, but I'm going to say like 10 fish, something like that would be amazing. A lot of these fish in here can be double figures. So, you know, if they're like 8, 9, 10 pounds, 10 fish is going to be a really big weight. And a lot of this open water fishing can be like that. Even if it was bream you were targeting. So I'm really pleased. This sort of gives me a license now, in my opinion. I treat them as, when you get one, it sort of buys you a cast, if you know what I mean. Well, I believe a fish sort of buys you another 2 casts at least. I always think a line or an indication, you can add an extra cast on. Do you understand that sort of mentality? Because that's what you've got to look for. You know, if you're getting any indications, or if you get a fish, that is evidence that there are fish there, and you should give yourself more time to catch it. You shouldn't just say, oh, I've had my 3 or 4 casts or whatever it is, and take it from there. There's big fish in here, so I am just gonna take my time. You know, this could be a small one, but this strong, strong fish. Just gonna tweak that clutch slightly. I love playing fish on a clutch. Got a speed drag on here, which is come in really handy when the fish absolutely roared off. So So you can see I'm just keeping the rod low, but look, even though I've got a long rod, I've got a nice soft action on the rod's bending through, all the way through, which is so important when you're playing these big fish. You know, there's a lot of pressure on these fish. I've still got elasticated stem as well. So I'm sort of stacking the odds in my favor, if you like, all the time. And I'll be really pleased to see this first one in the net because, like I say, we're only sort of setting ourselves low targets today. But this mentality applies to carp, bream, tench, anywhere where you might go big water fishing for a handful of fish. You know, you can effectively search your water like this. And hopefully, on the best days, you might catch the majority of your fish in one spot. But most of the time, if you save yourself somewhere to go, you might even get a big finish as well. But we'll look at that maybe a bit later in the session. Beautiful fishing. What brilliant fishing. That it can be really exciting. And your water doesn't have to be massive, by the way. You know, you might have a maximum cast of, say, 50 metres. Well, you can start at 30, work your way out to 50. You know, this isn't all about great big open waters. This is about where you haven't got a feature to fish to, where you haven't got an island or something like that. These fish are so healthy in here at JCB. And I must say, while we're playing this fish, a huge thanks to the Angling Club for allowing us to fish here today. It's not a day ticket water. We've had permission, so thank you to them, because it is a beautiful place to come fishing. Really is a great place. We have some Feeder Master qualifiers here as well. And again, they're fantastic events because it's exciting, you know, the fish can be big. We've had 20 pound carp caught out of here in those qualifiers. What a fish this is. What a feisty fish. I don't even think it's that big. I think it's probably 7 or 8 pound, but let's have a little look when it comes up. Still not giving in. Oh, looking like a nice common. Wonder why it was fighting so hard. You know, commons fight so hard. There he is, look. Got my 4 meter landing net handle. Gonna need it today because I want to get it at the first opportunity. Look how strong they are. Look how strong they are there. Just switched to a method feeder as well for that chuck, just to have a go on something different. And that has also worked, so that's good. Very interesting. There we go. I'll tell you what, I've underestimated that slightly. That is a big fish. Well into double figures, that carp. That is a very big, angry JCB fish. Let's just plonk my rod down here, see if you can take a little look at him. Wow, what a fish. Yeah, that's well into doubles, probably 11 or 12 pound. What an absolute cracker. That is how exciting open water method fishing can be. Just gonna slip her back. Oh, and then there she goes. When I'm fishing a big open water, I've talked about the fact that it can be quite daunting, certainly if you want to search the water, you want to search out into the lake. But I learned a long time ago that if you've got the right equipment, you've got the right tackle, it makes a huge, huge difference. Now, I'm actually going to start with my mainline choice because I feel this is one of the most critical aspects. I've got today an 028 10 pound shock leader on here, really thick line. I can cast it as hard as I possibly can and it's gonna be really durable. It's not gonna fail on me in terms of the line's not gonna fail. But if I had thick 10 pound line all on my reel, it'd be way too much resistance to cast out and it would end up not going very far. So I've actually got 018, which is 4 pound line on the reel. So once that initial 6 or 7 meters of shock leader goes out into the lake, I've just got thin line, so there's no resistance there, and that is crucial. And that no resistance is also matched with the reel. So I've got a 720 intensity here today. It's got a really big, deep spool on it. You can see it's filled to the max with line, absolutely to the limit. So the line's gonna come off this spool really easily. Now, if I take a normal 5,000 size reel and maybe filled it let's say 7/8, like you normally might do for a commercial fishing, I can guarantee that's gonna knock 10, 20% off your cast at least. So if you're trying to chuck 50, 60 meters, you're gonna struggle with those sort of differences. It'll be a lot easier for someone like me who's got the right reel and the right line on it. That's matched with the rod. I've got a 4 meter distance master today. This is like my ultimate open water rod. It's got a beautiful play in action. It's not a poker at all, but it can really, really sling a bait a long way. And that's important. If I'm gonna fish 50 or 60 meters, then it'll do it comfortably. Today, I'm actually exploring a bit further. You join me at this point where I'm well over 70 meters. So I'm gonna have to stand up, I'm gonna have to cast it hard, but I've got everything in my tackle to do that. 45 gram medium feeder, let's get it out there. It won't be a relatively big effort. And like I say, it's a long, long way that I'm fishing now. So if I didn't have that right equipment, I know I wouldn't be able to do it. So here we go. Right on the money. So really good, relatively easy to chuck a very, very long way if you've got the right equipment. So a really interesting move. I ended up catching 3 fish at about 50 meters. And a good hour's gone by since that last fish. And what happened was, after about 30 minutes, I decided to move, to make that significant move that I was telling you about, to 60 meters. I went about 10 meters further than I was. So I thought I'd almost get another run straight away, and I didn't. I didn't even get a single fish. And I just feel we've got a nice breeze blowing today. It's not cold, okay? It's still nice and warm. And I just feel the fish might be on the hunt for food. Now, interestingly, 2 of my 3 previous fish also came on a pellet, on an 8mm pellet. And that tells me a lot of the time that the fish are actively eating. So I came back to that original spot and I've put on the large Banjo feeder. Now, that large Banjo feeder, when it's loaded up, especially if you really load it to the max, you're talking about probably 4 times the amount of bait of a medium feeder. So it's a lot more bait. And I had 1 quick chuck for about 2 minutes, wound it in, chucked this one back out, and it wasn't in the water more than 2 minutes, and it's gone straight round. And I just wonder, and again, it's evidence why you can do something in fishing to make things happen. I just wonder if they want a bit of bait. So they actually backed off my area before because perhaps there wasn't enough food for them there. And perhaps by changing to this bigger feeder, the fish might be more keen to come in onto the food. So not quite as big this one. I had another double and one about 7. This one's looking about 5 or 6 pound, but an instant response. And you can see that it's a large Banjo feeder. Just bouncing around there. So much bait, you know, it's a lot of bait on a feeder, but by making that move, these fish are still fit as well. They're fighting well. So it's not always about that sort of searching mentality. Sometimes it's about changing things up where you are fishing. You know, we've already had a result and caught. It's a bit bigger than I thought again. We've already had a result by catching sort of 3 carp there anyway. So the fish were happy to be there. They just needed a bit more food. There we go. Nice mirror. Absolutely brilliant fishing. Brilliant fishing. Yeah, that one again is probably 7, 8 pounds, something like that. It's just hold her up there. You can see, look, there's the feeder. That large feeder's made a big difference there. Such fit fish. And a pellet again on the hook. Again, making a big difference. Got a nice strong hook on. I got a 12 kkh to 020 AccuPower with a band. So everything's really strong that I've got in there. Gonna just slip that one back as well. Just like to put them back like this, get the fish back in the water. I'm gonna have a little spell now. I'm gonna probably cast a little bit more regularly, and I'm gonna use that big feeder, and I'm gonna have a solid 40 minutes and just see if that response of bait can give me that sort of big run that I think that would really make this day something special. Talk to you a little bit about the hook that I'm using today and why I've chosen to go on with what I have. When I'm fishing with these sorts of feeders and I've got wafters on, I'm a massive fan of big circle hooks like MCM. We do 8s, 10s, 12s, and I love that style of hook. I think it's a great hook, and with a wafter in particular, I find it a really successful hook to use. Now, the only thing I've found is when I'm using heavier baits, I like a hook where the fish actually pricks itself. So because I'm using an 8mm pellet today, I've gone with a KKH, and that is a hook that I absolutely love. I've got it in a size 12. The point is straight to the shank of the hook, so it's very exposed. So when a fish sucks in the pellet, the point is so sharp and so straight and so open, it always pricks the fish. Now, because these hooks are so strong and such a great shape, I'm not worried about fish coming off. And I just feel that when I'm getting a few finicky fish feeding on these 8mm, 6mm pellets, I feel that that is a better hook choice for me than the MCM circle hook, which I still really like to use, but I like to use them when I'm using, say, lighter baits. Well, this fish has proved to me today that you really have to think on your feet while you're fishing. Since I've come back, I've been putting that large feeder in, and I've had probably 6 or 7 now on the bounce. And they've definitely moved to my bait. You know, I am pleasure fishing here today. It's a big open water, and it's a reminder for me, it's not all about moving. Sometimes the fish will come to find you if you can get the feeding right. And I think this is definitely what's happened here today. Big fish as well. You know, I'm gonna end up, I think this is my 9th or 10th in total now. You know, that's gonna be pushing on for 100 pounds. So brilliant, brilliant fishing. I haven't had to explore, and I've done it all with one rod, one reel, and a really simple setup. So you can go and enjoy open water fishing for big fish with not loads of tackle. You don't need loads, but you need the right tackle. You need the right setup. You know, and this rod can cast from 50 to 100 meters. The reel and the line is all perfect, and I think this is a really nice fish to feel on. It's not very fast, it's just lumping around, so I'm hoping it's a nice big mirror to finish my day on. Try and keep the rod low while I'm bringing him in. I've got a nice through action on my rod, so, and you'll see when this comes in, I'm still on that large Banjo. I've been on the mix of 50-50 1mm pellets and 2mm pellets. They are absolutely gobbling them up. Bites are coming relatively quickly now as well. I'm getting an odd liner. There's fish in the area. And this is a great way of fishing. Oh, what a fish to finish on. This is a nice fish. So if you want to get out there to your local water. And like I've said before, it could be bream, it could be carp, it could be big roach. Think about some of the principles that we've applied here today, using the tackle, using our bait, using our sort of like limits of where we can cast. And you could have days like this, because this is definitely a day to remember for me today. Look at this, what an absolutely huge fish this is to finish on. Just when you think you've got them beat, they go again, don't they? Brilliant, brilliant fishing. This is another double for definite. This could be the biggest of the day. This is nice fish, really nice fish. And there's several waters up and down the country where you can go and have a go at this. Like I say, even if your lake isn't the biggest, even if you've only got 30, 40 meters to cast, you can still use the same principles. Make sure your tackle's right. And make sure you're using your space best you can. Look at that. I'm certainly glad I've got strong tackle on, big hooks, big line, nice strong rod. Now that is a fish to finish. If I can get her. What a fish. Some places you go, carp just fight that little bit less. They've been caught a bit, but not here. What a fantastic water. The members at JCB really do have, because these fish have been really, really exciting today. Aggressive bites, pulling hard right till the last. Wonderful, wonderful fishing. Here she comes. This is a big double, this one. Go on, shuffle them in. That is a 20-inch net as well. What a way to finish my day. That is absolutely and utterly brilliant. That is a huge carp. They come in, those are eating machines. That has made all the difference. That fish is 15, 16 pound for sure. Let's hold it up. Oh, wow, look at that. Look at that, what an immaculate fish. I'm not gonna hold them too high, just there over the net. That is a huge, huge carp. What a session here at JCB. I hope you've enjoyed it. Yeah.